Okay, so I'll be going over a bunch of the Claude code news from last week, as well as some related things such as OpenSkills, also a brand new eval from Next.js, a brand new benchmark, and also some related Claude code plugins as well. So firstly, one of the biggest changes that we have is now we have a Claude code native installer that's much more stable and does not require Node.js. So previously, if you remember, when you were installing Claude code, you had to install Node, and then you had to install npm, and that was a bit of a hassle. But now you can install Claude code much more easily by using this brew command or installing it via the scripts instead. And if you already have Claude code installed, then you can use Claude install and it will switch over to a native installer. So you can see that if I run npm list g, then I have Claude code installed via npm. But now if I just run Claude install, then it will switch over to the native build version, which should be much more stable according to their like announcement. And if I run npm list g again, you can see that Claude code is no longer on this list because it's switched over to the native build instead. Some of the improvements here mean that the auto updater is much more stable and users should run into fewer failed updates and bricked installs. And that Claude code is now a self-contained executable and no longer has a Node.js dependency. So basically, if you're telling a friend to install Claude code for the first time, then you can just give them any of these commands and that should help them install it quickly. And then after that, you can tell them to watch my brand new Claude code masterclass that will also be linked down below. Okay, now if you run Claude code, one of the biggest changes you will see is that they're planning to deprecate output styles. So if you do slash output style, you will see that it will be removed on November 5th or later, and they'll automatically convert any output styles you have. And they basically recommend using plugins instead. And I think it's pretty nice because they're consolidating a bunch of features. They also recommend using system prompt files, system prompt, append system prompt, or any of these, basically whichever one gets the job done easily. I do go through all of them in my Claude Code Masterclass as well, so do check that out. A useful setting that they added to sandbox mode is allow unsandboxed commands. And basically a problem that was happening with some people, for example, this person on Reddit, they were running sandbox mode and then all of a sudden Claude code decided to manually override sandbox mode by running a bash command outside of sandbox mode. And how this works is that whenever Claude code tries to use a bash tool, it can set an additional parameter, dangerously override sandbox to true, which basically means that it won't check against a sandbox to see if that command is blocked or not. Now, in some cases that can be useful, but also you don't want to risk Claude code overriding the sandbox. So what you can do to prevent that from happening in your case is copy this over, then go to your sandbox, and then in brackets put like this, allow unsandbox commands to false. And that basically means that Claude code, if it tries to use a bash tool and then tries to manually override the sandbox, then it won't be able to. So that's probably more useful for enterprises who want to make sure that Claude code is running in a well-behaved sandbox. Hey, so as a short aside, in addition to my paid community, I launched a brand new free community earlier today. There are some vibe coding techniques that I shared in the community that I haven't talked about before on my YouTube channel. And also there are a bunch of templates to help kickstart your next vibe coding project off. You will be able to chat with people all around the world in the community. So if you are casually interested in vibe coding and want to chat with more people about it online, then this community will be a pretty good place to do so. There will be a link down below for those who are interested, so do check it out. Something else they added is a disallowed tools field to custom agent definitions for explicit tool blocking. So you can see that in my agents file, I have a webfetcher subagent that has disallowed tools, a webfetch, bash, and websearch. So obviously it's a webfetcher, and if it can't use bash, hence it can't use curl, and it can't do a web search, and it can't do a web fetch either, then obviously it's not going to be very useful. But now if I try running the subagent by calling the subagent explicitly and saying fetch masterclaudecode.com, then you will see it basically won't be able to fetch that particular website because it doesn't have any tools available to fetch any of the content from it. So instead, it tries to find out my local computer instead. But now if I remove the disallowed tools and then run the subagent again, and I say fetch masterclaudecode.com, which is my masterclass, then you will see that it actually is able to pass in that prompt and then do the fetch command, and I can press allow, and then it will basically fetch the content that's required from it. And then you can see it gives me a summary of the page. So this can be useful for specific subagents that you see inappropriately calling tools that they should not be allowed to call. You can just add that to the file. They also added prompt-based stop hooks, and I'm not exactly sure what that is. So I ran a stop hook to see if anything has changed, and it seems that nothing has really changed. And people on Reddit are also wondering the same thing, like, what is a prompt-based stop hook? So if you do know, then leave a comment down below of, like, what exactly that is, because I'm pretty confused. Anyways, they made a bunch of bug fixes over here, which we're not going to be going over. One thing they did do is they added a new planning subagent. So we can see this in action because if I make a change to my project type whisper, so that's my AI speech to text application. I want to add Speechmatix as well as one of the AI speech to text providers. So if I go to planning mode and basically say using the application, hey, can you add Speechmatix to this particular application? Here's a link to a website. And also paste a link to the website, press enter. You will see it will firstly call the explore subagent to first explore the code base to understand how it works and also fetch the website as well. And now you can see after fetching the information, it's calling this brand new plan subagent and it's passed in this prompt to plan subagent. So all the inner workings of that particular subagent will be deleted and only the final result will be kept and passed back to the main session. Anyways, what this means for you practically is that when you're using planning mode, you will not end up using as much of the context window as you previously did because the planning is now running within a subagent. You can also trigger the subagent manually by not using planning mode and then just doing @agent, and then you will see on the list called agent-plan, and that's right underneath the agent-explore. These are the free built-in subagents into Claude Code. Claude Code now also allows you to resume subagents. So you can see that I triggered a subagent here, which is a planning subagent, and I said come up with a detailed life plan. And now it's asking me some clarifying questions. It gave me a response. This response goes back to the main thread, the main general purpose agent. And then I can say continue with that subagent, resume it, to explicitly resume that subagent. And then Claude Code should be able to find that subagent and then resume the session that I was having with it. And if I review the transcript for that particular session, then I can see through the transcript that I actually resumed the old subagent instead of spawning a brand new one. Claude Code can also now choose a model used by its subagents. So I guess that means that if you now go to your subagent, for example, and then remove the model from this line, then it will choose the appropriate model for whatever task that it has in mind. But I don't think that I would really be using this because I know what models should be used by which subagents. And then there were a bunch of very small changes here. A pretty interesting project that I saw online recently is OpenSkills. And if you install it and then run OpenSkills Sync, it will bring Anthropic's skill system to all coding agents on your machine. So Claude Code, Cursor, Windsurf, and Ada. And basically, I think the way that it works is it injects this particular thing into the system prompt of all the other coding agents so that they're aware of whatever skills that are running and basically how they work. Another pretty interesting thing that I saw is the AI model performance evaluations for Next.js specifically. And basically they compared how different AI models and agents compare on Next.js code generation and migration, measuring success, execution time and token usage, and quality improvements. So basically you can see that GPT-5 codec seems to perform the best, has a high success rate overall for all these different tasks that are available in Next.js. And you can see how many tokens it used, how long it took on each of these tasks. And if you want to see the tasks themselves for that particular evolves, then that should be available on GitHub here. So it's quite interesting that GPT-5 codec does the best here. Claude Code Opus 4.1 does slightly worse at 40%. GLang 4.6 does surprisingly well. And sadly, it seems like Claude Sonnet 4.5 only gets 32% correct. So it's interesting that when it comes to Next.js specifically, then GLang 4.6 does better than Claude Sonnet 4.5. Then you can also see how different agents perform as well, such as Codex actually does worse for some reason. Cursor Composer does seemingly better, and Cursor running Sonnet 4.5 does pretty well. So anyway, this is probably worth looking through yourself if you're using Next.js quite a lot. Anyway, something else that is pretty interesting is that Scale AI came out with a brand new benchmark called the Remote Labor Index Benchmark that basically evaluates how good different AI agents are at performing real-world, economically valuable remote work. And basically what they did is they gathered 240 projects from Upwork across a bunch of different domains, so I think 23 different Upwork domains from 64 in total, excluding projects requiring physical labor, long-term evaluation, and direct client interaction. And from 550 projects, they now have 240 projects to be attempted. And then basically the value of all that work is $143,000. And then you can see all these different categories, and they basically evaluated the agents across all these different benchmarks. And basically the conclusions that they came to is that when it comes to absolute automation, like completing a project for a client end-to-end, Current agents perform near the floor. So you can see the highest performing agent, Manus, achieved a 2.5 automation rate in the sense that if that particular result was delivered to client, would the client actually accept that result? And then you can see how the other models do. So Sonnet 4.5 only got 2%-ish, GPT-5 got 1.6%, ChatGPT got 1.25%, then Gemini 2.5 Pro got 0.83%. But they say that whilst the absolute performance is low, ELO scores reveal a steady and measurable progress, so newer frontier models consistently rank higher than older ones, which means that probably over time they're going to be using this benchmark to actually evaluate how economically valuable these agents are. The most common failure modes for the failed projects was the quality was too poor, like agents produce a childlike or amateur quality work. The deliverables were incomplete, so they did not follow all the instructions for what kind of work should be delivered as a final result. Technical and file issues, so agents produced it corrupt, empty, or incorrect file formats, and then various inconsistencies as well. Anyways, this is pretty interesting. It will be linked down below alongside the actual paper as well, so I would recommend reading through it if you're interested. And I think that speaks to the capabilities of many of these agents right now. Like, an agent right now is not gonna like build your company from scratch. It would do a pretty bad job of that. At least when it comes to coding, a lot of people say that they're better at like really big auto-completion tasks. So it can auto-complete a lot of the code base for you, given that you have a good understanding of what things should be completed. But I was also watching the recent Andrew Kapoffi interview as well, and he talked about how when it came to one particular project that he was working on, it was really hard to use any of the coding agents because they really struggle when it comes to a code base, which is completely new. Like, it's not anything that has been done before, was incredibly rare. But they perform better when it comes to public frameworks or using techniques that are commonly and well used, which I think makes them better at like auto-completion tasks. Anyways, I'm going to be following this benchmark personally because I'm interested in seeing how well it performs over time. But it is pretty interesting that Claude Sonnet 4.5 does so well on the benchmarks and GPT-5 as well. I do wish they measured some of the Chinese models as well, but I think they will be improving on this benchmark over time. Anyways, that's basically it for the video. If you do enjoy this kind of stuff, then do subscribe to the channel because it lets me know that I should be making more of this. And if you do want to join my free community as well, then it will be linked down below. And also my Claude Code Masterclass will be linked down below as well.